It is hundreds of years into the future. Borders have been drawn across Valles Marineris, the superpowers of Earth compete with each other for the resources of the asteroid belt, and during a new moon, you can see city lights. We've imagined this future for decades, if not centuries, but assuming no aliens united Earth or undiscovered physics, how might we actually colonize the solar system? How would a nation spread across multiple planets and moons operate? And aside from the thrill of going to space or being in a new frontier, why would people want to settle these inhospitable environments? We are not going to have a city of a million people on Mars by 2050 or anything like that, but whatever you think of space, it's hard to deny that our modern world is already heavily dependent on it. It's called satellites. While today we're watching unfold a brand new chapter in spaceflight, what with private businesses launching people to Earth's orbit and NASA working on going back to the moon, really, I want to look at things going further into the future, when tickets to space are as relatively cheap as a transatlantic flight, and we have the infrastructure to support millions of people in places that we were wholly not designed to live in. Now, of course, keep in mind that saying this is all hypothetical is a massive understatement. The only even kind of permanent outposts we've ever actually put in space are space stations in low Earth orbit. So we're operating under a lot of assumptions regarding human biology, economics, and just the fact that humans don't always act the way you think they will. This is basically just a long-winded version of me saying, there aren't many sources out there that I can really rely on, so as a result, most of what I say here I'm really just pulling out of my ass. The real question though is not just which worlds to settle, but where on each world to settle. The ideal locations for a colony are places with ample water, and ideally also something to dig up and export back to Earth. Or at the very least, something to make tourism profitable. Expect some sort of tacky gift shops at the Apollo landing sites. When it comes to the moon, yeah, you space and sci-fi nerds in the comments already know I'm going to mention Shackleton Crater. Its position on the moon's south pole allows the rim of the crater to receive nearly continuous sunlight, while on the inside, the crater hasn't seen light in billions of years, allowing ice deposits to stay intact for all this time and not get boiled off by the solar winds. The moon is the closest major body to Earth, is incredibly rich in metals and minerals, and it's very easy to launch something off its surface. And this is where it can essentially serve as our gateway to the solar system.
But here's the thing. Even if the moon was covered in pre-made gold bars, flying to the moon with our current rockets and taking them back to Earth still wouldn't make enough money to break even. Luckily, the lunar surface has an ace up its sleeve that you might have heard of. Helium-3, a perfect fuel for nuclear fusion power, which is incredibly scarce here on Earth.
But the Beardy Penguin, I do ask, couldn't you just fuse hydrogen, which is much more common for power, or even to just straight up make helium-3 here on Earth? Wouldn't that just be a lot cheaper than setting up shop on the moon?
You certainly could, but it's a really bad idea, and I have a whole video explaining why over on my channel. The world won't be powered by clean fusion energy until we have a supply of helium-3, which the moon is perfectly suited to provide.
Another great place to mine for metals and minerals, of course, are asteroids, like Eros. Oh, I'd be careful there. However, you don't have to go all the way out to the belt for a metal-rich asteroid, as a lot of asteroids cross Earth's orbit. While these asteroids are still much further away than the moon, if they're light enough, they can be slowly towed into Earth's orbit. Of course, the moon and all the asteroids in the solar system don't actually have more of most metals than Earth does. The real attractive force to space mining is the fact that unlike here on Terra Firma, there aren't any villages to destroy or natural habitats to bulldoze or ecosystems to poison with industrial waste. Space mining might be the next big industry, or it might not. But building the infrastructure to allow for such operations would almost certainly be our ticket to becoming an interplanetary species. Manufacturing on the lunar surface out of lunar materials can be a great way to construct larger and larger space stations and spacecraft for interplanetary voyages, as one doesn't need nearly as much fuel to launch something into orbit of the moon compared to the ludicrous amounts needed to launch something into Earth orbit. Realistically, once the largest lunar colonies have a large-scale mining and manufacturing sector going on, the only things that really need to be launched from Earth are the people who want to go on these expeditions, and potentially things like fresh soil and other essential things that can't be made off-world. Start with Luna and any near-Earth asteroids, and the colonization of space could be a mountain that gets easier to climb with every step, but is like still insanely hard to make the first few steps. Maybe it's shaped like this, I don't know. So now that we have our gateway to the solar system, where next? Mars is somewhat interesting economically speaking, in that there isn't really all that much money to be made there. Mars does have a lot of metals and minerals, but it's the wrong mix of too big and too far away for it to be worth the cost of shipping everything back to Earth. even if you make super cheap and light single-use re-entry capsules on-site, which I don't see why you wouldn't do that anyway. So anyone sponsoring a program to set up a colony on Mars would probably be looking for something other than money. If we're to use the ever-popular, if not flawed, metaphor of the colonization of the Americas, Mars is less of a Jamestown venture and something that gives off more Plymouth-y vibes. That is massively oversimplifying the origins of the United States to the point where you really shouldn't quote me on that, and actually the colonization of the Americas really isn't that good of a metaphor for the colonization of space, but just as an analogy, I think my point stands. Therefore, a Mars-based economy would probably be more of a white-collar economy. New technologies could be easily developed here that would revolutionize life on Earth, like better farming or water recycling technologies, but California was not settled because people really wanted to start Silicon Valley. And Silicon Valley doesn't have to be on Mars. Mars does have upsides compared to the moon though. For instance, the atmosphere shielding colonies from micrometeorites and some of the radiation. But Mars would not be the place to go to make money. Really what Mars offers us is the hope of eventually terraforming the planet into a second Earth. A process which would take hundreds if not thousands of years and that we could irreversibly mess up at any moment. Para-terraforming could also be a good option. Basically, instead of terraforming an entire world or building a giant O'Neill cylinder from scratch, find a crater or a valley or a lava tube or something, then seal it off and build your habitat inside that. Again, that's something for the far future, but if a large enough economy grows on Mars, this is where the outer solar system might come to shine. One thing Mars lacks is nitrogen, which Venus and Titan are incredibly rich in. Although you might as well go to Titan because it's much smaller and you can easily make a tourist resort out of those liquid methane seas. And it doesn't hurt to get any extra water from the asteroid belt or the moons of Jupiter and Saturn, just to kickstart their economies. Hey, I said colonizing the solar system, not just the moon and Mars. I can easily go on a whole tangent about how our colonies might be built or the spacecraft we'd use to get to them and bring stuff back, but that's better left for another video. Possibly on Celestium, but assuming these scientific bases turn into mining outposts, or something that at least makes enough money to warrant continued investment, and the population grows with people in these outposts beginning to bring their families and turn them into colonies, and those colonies grow into cities as more job opportunities open up at the Nordstrom near Elysium Mons, how exactly will these colonies be governed? For the first few decades, when these colonies are little more than scientific or mining outposts at the edge of civilization, these bases would essentially be run like ships or Antarctic research bases. But as they grow and people move in permanently, the people living there would want some representation in the laws they still have to follow, whether or not the regolith below them happens to be sovereign territory. Or actually, probably more likely the regolith above them because of radiation protection, but okay, I already said that was another video. Now, this is really where things start to go into the realm of an educated guess, basically no more than realistic fiction, but it's likely that colonies on and around the moon would remain close to Earth, not just out of proximity, but also from how intertwined their two economies would be. I'm not saying this will be the case, I'm just saying this is the most logical outcome, not that many things in human history would bring joy to your average Vulcan. Martian colonies, and colonies anywhere further out in the solar system, however, would have to be completely self-sufficient, maybe except for more complicated things that people can afford to wait a few months for. This is where I think the analogy of European colonization of the Americas actually holds some weight, or I guess should I say mass? As reaching the moon can take days and reaching Mars months, even after waiting for a transfer window. We're just gonna assume the Epstein drive isn't invented yet. Not to mention the communication delay, which can be hours by the time you get to the outer planets. But to the vast empires that existed before the telegraph and the railroad, that's just how things worked. When Spain, Portugal, and France colonized what would become Latin America, much of North America, they set up viceroyalties, territories ruled by a viceroy, who in this case was basically a governor who operated on behalf of the monarch back in Europe. So these future colonial territories might be granted a significant amount of autonomy. On the other hand, look at this advertisement for the Pony Express, advertising only 10 days to San Francisco, and consider the fact that California already became a fully fledged state 10 years before the Pony Express operated, and suddenly Utopia Planitia or Kraken Mare gaining full-on statehood doesn't sound all that far-fetched either. When nations inevitably decide to expand their successful colonies, how they do so might differ between worlds. On Luna, with such low gravity and no real atmosphere whatsoever, traveling long distances would be trivial, and selenographic features might have little to do with how borders are actually shaped. The larger, more expansive of these colonies would probably be chopped up and spread all throughout the lunar surface. and the borders would probably look like a giant space Colorado, maybe with an occasional extra blob if there were resources in the area or another country's base that they wanted to avoid. This will be even more so the case with even smaller bodies like Ceres. On Mars, however, the story is a bit different. Sure, Mars's gravity and atmosphere are practically nothing compared to Earth's, but even they would probably be enough for nations to want to consolidate their colonies in one or two particular areas. While colonies in the Sea of Tranquility and Mare Frigoris could easily ship people and resources between one another on suborbital spacecraft, on Mars, colonies in the Tharsis Montes would probably end up having little to do with those in Acidalia Planitia. Thus, the borders here would probably pay more attention to the local areography. Wow, this is a pretty steep cliff. Well, I guess China can have everything on the other side. Where nations might clash, however, or as we like to call it on Geopolitics Tube, the juicy bit, are mineral and especially water deposits. The Outer Space Treaty is a multilateral treaty between 114 nations and another 22 signatories that forms the basis of international space law. In a sense, there are three major points relevant to what we're talking about. 1. No nuclear bombs in space. 2. Everything in space shall be the common heritage of all mankind, so like no claiming stuff as your sovereign territory. And 3. Any spacecraft or space stations or whatever that you put in space do still count as yours, just like any ship on the high seas or any research base in Antarctica, which, remember, you also aren't allowed to claim. This would almost certainly make the solar system a bit of a wild west when it comes to which nation gets to mine which deposits. Basically, if you can mine it, you can have it, but also don't expect not to share it if someone else builds a base, here. If things start to get a little out of hand with this, especially since the Outer Space Treaty doesn't actually ban conventional weapons in space, there might end up being some, shall we say, gentle modifications of the treaty once things get more established on a particular body. Maybe at least a Treaty of Tordesillas thing just to keep us from LARPing Season 2 for all mankind. Certain parts of space itself can be, and already are, extremely important real estate. Nations today already have the ability to reserve certain specific orbits around Earth, so that their satellites can steer clear of others. However, a perhaps even more coveted piece of literally nothing are Lagrange points. Lagrange points are where the gravity between two different bodies, like Earth and the Moon or Earth and the Sun, are effectively evened out, meaning anything placed there can essentially stay in the same position with very little correction fuel, whatever staying still means in the context of spaceflight. One of the Earth-Moon Lagrange points, for instance, would be a great place for a station connected to the lunar surface by a space elevator, since it will stay in orbit above the same part of the lunar surface without wrapping around the moon like a giant fruit roll-up. The problem with Lagrange points, however, is that there aren't very many of them, and they aren't really that big, so you can't really share them unless you share a same space station. Between any two bodies, there are only 5 of these points, one of which is completely useless for a lunar space elevator, but would be a great place for a space station that doesn't officially exist.
Did you find the secret Martian space station behind the sun yet?
Nah, I've gone blind.
When it comes to the far future though, while it's incredibly common for sci-fi planets and moons to be completely homogeneous like giant city-states, that sort of goes against one fundamental fact about planets. They are very big. Mars is the size of all of Earth's landmasses put together, so a nation encompassing all of Mars would single-handedly become the largest nation in human history. And actually, the same thing would be the case for the Moon, which is about the size of Africa, or more than twice the size of Russia. And yes, bigger than the British Empire. Look, what I'm really saying is, if you are a sci-fi writer and you want to spice things up or add in a bit of realism, draw some borders on your planets. Even for vast multiplanetary empires. People can share planets. I mean, we've been doing it with this one for thousands of years, and it almost works. So, why talk about space at all if we're not even fully sure we'll make it there? Well, first, because space is cool and I do not recognize any contradicting opinions as coming from a sane mind. Second, while space is almost certainly our future, it also points to our past. We live in an age where you can go everywhere we've ever discovered within a few days, and instantly communicate with virtually every human in existence, depending on whether or not you can find their email address. That is not something we have usually had in human history. Thus, we can look to our records of the past to inform our predictions of our uncertain future, and we can look to the future to inform our knowledge of our increasingly distant past. Right, so remember to check out Beardy's video, and I'll see you in the not quite so distant future.